Hello, welcome to this week's art class. Today I want to talk about mixing colors. So I have three different colors I'm going to be using. Well, three plus white. I guess I could bring the white in here. But the three colors I'm going to be using are, let's see if I can read this right, anthraquinone blue. Anthraquinone blue, which is a very, very dark color of blue. I also have alizarin crimson hue, which is a red, but it's more of a purple red. And this is an Indian yellow hue. So this is kind of a dark yellow, if that makes sense, kind of close to orange. So when I mix these two colors, red and yellow, usually you get orange. But because of the purpleness of the red, it fights against the orange and the yellow. So I get more of a grayed out orange. I can't get bright orange with these two, which is a limitation. But sometimes when I'm doing portraits, it's nice to limit yourself just to make it look like a nice painting. And that way you don't have to match all of the colors perfectly of the person you're trying to paint. So, anyways, I'm gonna just put some of these out on my palette here. I'm gonna try out this vertical wax paper. So hopefully you can see me mix it a little bit clearer. So that's my blue. And then over here I'm gonna put my yellow, Indian yellow. And this is the alizarin crimson, which is a purpley kind of red. That's a nice color. And all three of these have kind of a nice, warm, natural look to them. So once I've got my three colors on the page, or on the palette rather, then I'm gonna add some white. I'm actually gonna put the white along the bottom here. I've been trying out different ways of setting out my palette because I don't know which way works best for me yet. I also have this stuff called an open thinner. Basically just makes the paint a little bit wetter without using water, because sometimes water messes with the consistency, but just to, if you don't have this, water will work fine for that purpose. But I've sketched this out with charcoal, actually. That's why it's kind of smudgy, because I don't have to use an eraser. I can just use my finger to kind of move it around. And I took about an hour or maybe 2 hours to do this. It ran through several iterations, which actually I can show you on screen. So here they are. So you can see, first I moved the eyes up after my first try, and then I kind of made the hat bigger and everything a little bit wider till I thought it looked correct. And this is gonna give me a guide. And if you're wondering what these other little lines are, that was areas where shadow met light. So I'm looking at the picture that I'm gonna try to be replicating, and I can see on her cheek there's a little bit of light, but then most of this side's in shadow. And on her chin as well, the line between the shadow and the light side is right about there in the middle. There's a little bit of shadow to the our left of her nose, and yeah. So that's what those lines are. They're kind of split, showing me where to change colors, essentially. Because I'm not going to paint the whole face one color. I'm going to try to keep a bunch of colors going. So I'm actually going to start in the shadow with this color here, which I'm seeing as kind of a mix of the colors. So I'm going to take my orange, yellow, and mix in some of this red. I can see the red overpowers the orange quite a bit. So I'm gonna need more orange than red if I want an even mixture. I've got this color now, which is a pretty bright orange. So I wanna actually make that a little bit dimmer. So I'm gonna add a little bit of our third color in. So if I add too much, it'll turn green, but let's see, if I just add a little bit, it should just darken it up to this sort of brown. Now this is closer to where I want. I'm gonna add some white to kind of dilute that and lighten it up. That'll also show me what color it is a little bit more. Okay, that's pretty good. I do want a little bit more grayness in it. So I'm actually gonna keep going with the blue and a little bit of red. Because this is gonna be the, maybe the deepest shadow area. Maybe a little bit more blue even. So I want it to be pretty dark. A little more red. I don't want it to be green, so I'm adding red, which is opposite of green. Okay, I've got kind of color there. So now I'm gonna add a little bit of this thinner, just so hopefully this will help me like paint less, go a little bit longer without gumming up. Okay, and then I'm just gonna paint everything that's in that darkest shadow area. Once I'm putting it on, it looks a little bit too brown, so I'm gonna mix some blue into it. There we go, that's better. And I'm just, yeah, gonna kind of try to paint the areas that are kind of the darkest with this. So under her eye, and then kind of under her hair up here. And then maybe under her chin. All right, now I'm gonna lighten this up quite a bit and add some red to get it out of that green zone a little bit more. All right, now this color is gonna be I'm just gonna keep going in those same shadow areas, but it's a little bit lighter. Definitely more pinkish. Now, you might be thinking, this looks wild. And it sure does, but I think it's important in this first stage to just trust your mixing. And just kind of go for it with a lot of colors. As long as you have these sort of guides to help you get in the right spot, you should be okay. Add a little bit more red now. Cause I notice on the face, there's certain areas around the cheeks, the ears, fingertips. We have a little bit more warmth in it, which means a little bit more red going on in those areas. So, keep that in mind. Okay, so moving right along, filling in the rest of those areas. I think I need to make a little bit lighter color. A little bit more of this orange, brighten it up. I think of yellow as a brightener, so when I want to kind of show the sun shining on something or reflection, yellow is probably a good idea. So moving right along, adding this warmth now with this yellower area. You can see how I'm kind of just kind of pushing the color a little bit in every direction so I don't get a bunch of the same color going on my face. I'm just looking at my picture thinking, oh, that's too green up here, so I'm gonna go ahead and warm that up a little bit. I need a little bit lighter now. With a little bit more of this yellow maybe. And then that'll be... And yeah, you can go right over the areas you've already done if you feel the need to. Adding this really deep red now into the ears, and then I'm gonna add it to the middle of the lips. So I'm gonna end up covering my whole drawing, which is a little bit, makes me a little nervous every time I paint. It's like, oh no, my guide is gonna disappear at a certain point, and then I have to go off my painting. And that's okay, because I know that I got this far from drawing, and I can always keep rebuilding my drawing with paint on top. And it's a little bit of a leap you have to take when you're painting. So I'm just looking around. Anytime I mix the colors, I've made this really red. I wanted to get some in the lips and the ears, but I didn't want to let that be the only places that color existed. Because it's always nice to have little friends of the color moving around, if that makes any sense. Just, repetition in music, the same thing. I'm listening to John Coltrane. A nice, gentle side of John Coltrane right now. And he will repeat a melody that he's improvising a couple times. Or maybe he'll play the same melody higher and lower. Stuff like that. And it's that repetition that makes us aware, and we kind of can understand it when a piece of music repeats. It really helps us. And it's the same thing in art too, because if you repeat a color, not just in one spot on your painting, but a couple spots, maybe there's one main spot, and little dashes here and there of other stuff. Anyways, I'm gonna try to go really light now and try to fill in some of this light area. So I'm gonna make a light color out of this yellow with a little bit of the red in it, just to pink it out a little bit. Okay, now that color I see kind of in the around the cheeks areas. Maybe a little bit more green in it for this area up here. Shoot. Accidentally grabbed some of that red from the ear. That's okay. I'm gonna try to rebuild this side. Sometimes with acrylic paint, since it dries so quick, it's best if you make a mistake to just leave it. Because once it's dry, you can paint over it really easy. But if you try to mess with it while it's wet, it'll kind of mix your colors together, and it's generally a thing I have to remind myself not to do, is don't try to fix your mistakes until you're revisiting them when it's dry. So I'm now kind of putting in this brighter Well, I'm looking for brighter areas of the face to put them on, because the sun's coming from this direction, so in order for the face to look correct, I have to put the light in the right spot. This is how painters get kind of a three-dimensional feel to their paintings, is with light and shadow. Cool, I'm liking this so far. I need a very bright and maybe a little bit more red color, so I'm gonna mix right into that white here, because I need to brighten it way up. Alright, now that I have that kind of pinker color, yeah, I'm gonna add that to the cheeks. Nose a little bit. Alright, I'm going to darken up this red a little bit and try to capture some of the right side right there on the cheek. There we go. Alright. I'm going to wash off my brush a little bit. And go with another very bright color. I'm just gonna pull straight white this time and paint the very brightest areas now. See, I'm using a pretty quick approach. I'm not taking my time on any details. You might want to take more time at first, or you could try to just go for it like I am, and then let it dry, and then fix it, and then let it dry, and then fix it, and let it dry, and fix it, and just go through that, those motions, until you feel like, oh, the painting looks good. Sometimes it takes me weeks to get to there, but that's okay, that's part of the process. I'm hoping today I'll get there. Oh, yeah. Sometime reasonable. So I've just made like a, oops. Anytime I accidentally do a brush mark that's like, whoa, that messes it up, I can take it off on my thumb. Anyways, I got like a really orangey, bright orange color now that I'm kind of placing here and there. And you can make a choice at a certain point if you start to stray away from what the model looks like. You can make a choice to keep pursuing that model and keep trying to paint them as they are exactly, or you could choose to turn the corner and just try to paint a person. Maybe it's not exactly like who you're trying to draw. That's okay. So I'm making a little bit of a greener color. I need it to be a little bit more right there. Because I'm going to take this color and paint the rim of this hat, which I'm noticing is a similar color to what I had on my brush, so I always try to look around. You can look around in the background too, not just on the face, but elsewhere for colors. Like, I see this same greenish color in her hair a little bit. Up here, maybe. And a lot of this color that I'm gonna be putting down right now will get covered up with other stuff. But you start to build layers of color, and that's really where painting looks extra beautiful, in my opinion. I'm gonna also use some of this in the river behind, but only in this front area. So that'll serve to unite her hair a little bit with her hat, with the background. I don't know. I think it'll look nice. Tips. Green isn't usually a desirable color for a person. Because, I don't know, looks a little sick. Where's my water? But reds and warm colors, browns, yellows, pinks, those types of colors are more healthy looking in a person. So sometimes even blues. You can use greens in the background to really make those reds and warm colors pop out. Because if we look at a color wheel, we can see that red and green are opposites of each other. And if you can include opposites, like even in the shadows of her face, there's some green. Then that'll just really make the intensity and paintingness of the piece stand out. So I'm pretty happy with where I am. I gotta keep going or else this paint will dry up on my palette here. I don't want that. So I'm gonna try to kind of fill in the areas that I haven't yet. By moving around my palette, I've got like a yellow area, a brown, a green, and a red area that are developing. So these are the starting colors, but they've developed into this kind of shape. So it's kind of fun to watch how your colors kind of build themselves on the palette too if you work this way. Okay, a little bit. Okay, I'm gonna go deeper into the shadows now. So I'm gonna make a much bluer color over here. Because I don't necessarily want green in the shadows. I think that a little bit of a purpley blue gray might be good. Let's just try that out. Maybe a little bit of this green there. Yeah, something like that. And if it doesn't work, maybe just, now that I'm looking at it on the palette, I think just little hints of this might be nice, but it's a little bit too extreme, actually. Sometimes you can't tell on your palette, you have to put it on the painting to realize that. So I'm gonna make this a little bit more of a warm color by mixing it back into this red and this color here. Maybe this will be a little better. That's close. I think a little bit darker. So a little bit more blue and red. There we go. Yeah, that's a little bit more natural. Alright, and I still have some dark to go after this one, too. I'm just kind of now making some of the dark areas even darker. And then I'll go in probably with the bright areas, make them even brighter. But not all of them, just the areas that I see that are, oops, that's too bright, you know. Or, oops, that's the wrong color. And just kind of work around the painting like that. Right now, I'm pretty much just focusing on the darks and lights, though, not too much on the color. Though, every once in a while, I switch to kind of like a color mode in my brain, and I look around like I am now for where I could use this color. I think I need to thin it out. It's starting to get a little dry on my brush. So if I thin it out, it should be a little bit more easy to paint with, especially little thin lines. Thin lines kind of require thin paint. All right. I'm gonna use this gray that I just built now on the gravel here. Now I want to not paint it like I was I'd be painting a house, trying to make the wall all one big stroke. You know, no. I want my little brush strokes in, so I like to paint these big areas with them. You know. Really roughly. Again, I can wait till that dries and go over it a second time. So use that to your advantage and don't just scrub the paper. Think of each brush stroke as a sticker or something. Pick up the sticker, put it down. And you can usually pick up multiple stickers at once. Wash your brush pretty often too. That's something I need to keep reminding myself. I think a little bit of this gray actually might do good in the hair. So I'm gonna take a little bit more of this gray, put some right here in the hair. Cool. All right, I'm itching to do the shirt because of that nice blue, but since I have closer to a gray color, I'm gonna do some of the hat and the stuff that's a little bit closer to the color I've already put on there, just so I don't have to waste all these nice mixes that I've already made. So I'm gonna grab this kind of green color, see how that looks. I need lighter. Yeah, that's pretty good. And I'm gonna try to kind of match the texture of this, but I don't have. I'm not gonna draw in all the stitches. But like I said before, take advantage of being able to let the paint dry and go over a second coat. And if you just use brush strokes all around, it's pretty easy to get a really nice texture that kind of mimics a checkerboard or something. So I'm evenly spacing out all my strokes as best I can, but without being too careful, just trying to keep that general rule. Just like I only chose three colors, I also want to only choose maybe three different types of brush stroke. So, and now I'm doing just short little movements. Where else could I use this green? Maybe a little bit in the hair. There we go. Beautiful. What's another brush stroke I've used? Actually, I pretty much kept it at that one single one, which one is even, it's a look. I like having just one. Anyway, so I'm gonna go to the next maybe closest color, which would probably be the rest of the water here, which for me is a very bright green, so I'm actually gonna mix, oh, that was too much blue. Spoiling my color area a little bit here, but let's see. Maybe that's a green for sure. I'm gonna mix that into white now. I think I need more yellow. It's okay to use all the rest of my yellow because I don't want it to dry up. I do want it to get used. And I'm gonna put in some of the shadows of the rocks before I put them in. I have to kind of unhook this in order to get to it. So, yeah. I'm gonna do some of these shadows of the rocks. So I can't really see them up in this area, but I'm gonna do a little bit and keep the strokes horizontal, because I can only see a little bit under the rocks, and I'm gonna cover most of this up. Try not to go over the ones I did before too much. It doesn't matter if I go over her shirt because I haven't painted that yet, so I can always paint right over it. A little bit more of the yellow in it. A little bit more of the white in it. It's nice to have a variety of tints and hues, which just means add a little bit of color, a little bit of white as you're painting. Just keep shifting your color around, because then it just makes your painting look a little more interesting. Now this is really gray color. I hope I can make it a little bit brighter. But let's see what we got here. That's some blue. I need to make this brighter too. All the rest of the yellow. Just to see if we can get a little bit more green going on. Alright, I think this is as far as we're gonna go with this mix. Again, we can always... Now this time I'm actually gonna go over most of these ones I just did. Just right over the top, just leaving the bottom area, because I want the shadow to be thin under things, so... I'm going above all the strokes I just did in that darker green with... I'm also putting it elsewhere, but I'm going to make sure to cover up, because I want those to be thin strokes. So you can see how I can use this big brush to get thin lines with the process of overpainting. Alright, where else can I use that green color I just made? Maybe in her eyes a little bit. There we go. A little bit of hair. That you are still burning inside. I like this song. Okay. Alright, I like that. Alright, time to wash my brush here. Now, I think I'm gonna add this red and try to go for the hair, which is a deep brown color. So, I don't know what this is gonna do, but let's see where we get. If I get some red, go for anything with yellow in it, just to use that up. I'm not gonna get there, but I can use this purple color in the ear a little bit. A bit in the lips. we're going to the shirt now. So I'm unable to get the hair color right with this brush right now. So I'm gonna take this nice blue that I just made and I'm gonna paint the brighter areas with it. Even though it's already a pretty dark color. Maybe a little bit more of this color mixed in here. It's nice to, yeah, create brothers with your colors here. Where you're mixing an old color that you used for another part of the painting. That's why I like to pour plenty of paint on my palette. Not too much, just enough to keep it going for a decent amount of time. So right now I'm kind of focusing on most of the lighter areas, believe it or not, of the shirt. I'll go in with another lighter shade after this, but for now I just want this kind of nice blue to come through. Now I'm gonna try to make it much darker. So I'm gonna mix this blue with a substantial amount of red in here. Now I've got a quite darker color that's more purple, which I'm gonna put in the transitions, because I think I can go even darker for the darkest areas. I'll need to wash my brush, but I think I can mix a darker color. But this color for now is going to fill up probably most of the shirt now. Now you can see I did a curved line. I'm throwing those in every once in a while because it's nice to have a little bit of curves. They're more lyrical and more kind of poetic. I think of them like that. Yeah, because they're curving and less exact, and the straight lines are more, technical and very necessary in order to draw things accurate. But they can be a little bit cold, and I think that's where curves are really nice. I was just throwing that color a little bit into the hair. Again, because it's nice to have the color spread out around your painting a little bit, not just... I'm not going to add it to the background though, because I want all the dark colors to be on the subject here. Alright, continue on this shirt here. I'm kind of letting the strokes be a little bit longer, not by much, but a little bit longer than I was on the face. Just because as we move away from the face, which is the most important part of this picture, it becomes less important to make it detailed. And that's what, just like we see when we look at something, we don't look at everything in our field of vision at once. Like if I was looking at this room, right now I'm just focused on this one little panel in front of me with the painting on it. And everything else, if I'm not looking directly at it, looks a little bit blurry. And you can try that for yourself. Look at something on your desk or on the floor, and everything else that you're not looking at, you can tell it's there in your side vision, but you can't really see the details or anything. So try to keep that in mind when you're painting too. Not everything in the scene needs to be in focus. Sometimes some kinds of paintings, it's nice to have everything in focus because it, you know, it's more of a fantasy. But I think for portraits especially, but even for landscapes or other types of painting, you can use that principle. Alright. I'm gonna wash my brush now. I wanna get all the paint off my brush this time. Usually I've been just kinda dipping it once in water. Cause I wanna get, when you want the extremes, like really bright or really dark or really light or really colorful, whatever, you wanna wash your brush. If you don't mind it being a little bit gray, which most of this painting is so far, then you don't really have to wash your brush too thoroughly. Cause when the colors all mix together, they make gray. So, for a lot of the painting, I think that's a good thing. It's nice to have a grayness in there because no color in real life really shows up. So, wow, that made a great black, oh my gosh. No color in real life is that bright or dark, except for really little bits usually. Sometimes, you know, like a sign or something might get to that dark, but for the most part. This makes a really nice black between the two. It's actually a really dark purple. And I'm gonna use that as the black, the darkest areas. And it will look good too because it's essentially the same colors, just less grayed out. So I'm gonna try to I'm thinking about it. This music might not. I hope it lets me upload it with all this Coltrane in the background. If not, I'll cut it out. But, well, actually, I don't even know if it's coming up on the microphone, but it's really lovely. Anyways, I'm just doing more of this shirt, filling it in here. Where else can I use really dark black on this? I think under the ear. The middle of the eyes, probably, it could be this dark. This is gonna be risky. I think maybe this one needs to be a little bit to the left. Yeah, that's pretty good. Maybe the eyelashes as well. See how I'm building the eyes just like I'm building anything else? I have to be a little bit more close in and careful around them. But with the same big brush and with similar motions as everything else, just kind of shortened versions. So where else is black? There's some coming out of the hair here. All right. So where are we? So I got, so I was talking to Ginger for a second. Got this dark color still on my brush. I wanna use it again before I haven't poured out any more paint yet, so I'm kinda happy about that. Usually by this point I have to pour out more paint. But I got this stuff that's called Golden Open Acrylics. And it's like a special kind of paint that is like acrylic paint, but it dries extra slow. And I picked some of this up because I like working with acrylics because it's less messy. I can do it like this with a music stand. It's actually really convenient. But it dries so dang quick on the palette that I don't get to do this fun mixing that I do with oil. But it's really cool because I can still do that now. The more mixing as I go style. but it's acrylic and it still dries pretty quick. It's not like anywhere close to oil paint and how oil paint takes days to dry. But it's certainly an improvement for my style, at least. The first time I painted with them, I actually didn't really like it, and I was struggling with the consistency of the paint because it is a little different. It's different than it's different than acrylics, and it's definitely different than oils too. So you have to kind of get used to the way it feels, but it's sure nice. Yeah. Got most of the shirt. And you can see I'm doing these kind of zigzags down the shirt, and I think that helps the wrinkliness of the shirt. It's kind of baggy because she's sitting down here. Wow. Alright. I'm liking that so far. I'm gonna wash my brush again. What colors do I have left on here? I have white. I've used most of my blue, but I've got a lot of red. So, in effort not to waste that red, I'm gonna add some more yellow now. And try to make the hair color. Because the hair color is orange, but like I said at the beginning of the video, this red is gonna kind of neutralize the orange because this red has some purple in it. So watch, if I have some, I'm a little out of view here. Well, here's some orange here. I'm just gonna do a little test on here. And if I add red to it, it gets to be orange, but then it starts getting like pretty, it gets dark and brown. So I guess I could use that for my darker brown areas. I still got quite a bit more orange than everything else I have so far, huh? So that you can see it pops out quite a lot. So actually that mix is gonna work for me okay. I thought it would be too dark. It's actually almost too bright. Another testament to only just try out the color a little bit and don't just go with it. You've got to kind of see how it looks on the palette, adjust. And I'm just looking for more areas. A little bit of this coming out of the nostril. Do the darker areas of it. So that color I just mixed here, basically I'm just gonna do a darker version of that, so a little bit more red into it. Maybe a little bit of this blue, this dark blue above it, I'll just throw that right in there too. Need a little bit more red now. See, now that blue really darkened it down. See, I'm not adding black when I want things to be darker. I either add this red or the blue, depending on also what color I want it to be. I think this is a nice color that I was trying to make. Cool. Hopefully this is in focus. Let me just check. Yeah, the mixing board's a little bit blurry, but so I apologize for that, but this seems to be in focus. So you can see now as I'm painting these browns, which are closer to her actual hair color. I'm painting those on the top now of several different colors. So we have arrived at the correct color, but there's all these interesting things going on underneath. Whoa, that was weird. I got some blue somehow on there. Speaking of tones underneath, I just spoiled some of them. Oh well. Gotta roll with the punches. Okay, I wanna actually get a little bit darker, so I'm gonna add this blue in, add more of the red. Probably use the rest of the red, actually. I'm gonna get a little bit more of that red tones in here, down here where I spoiled them a little bit. And under the ear. My hair's looking nice. And I'm doing like long strokes for the hair, which contrasts with all the short strokes of everywhere else. Now I'm gonna go for even this darker tone. Maybe add a little more yellow to it. I want it nice and brown, but dark. So then I'll throw in this blue again. I think that's good, yeah. And with this color, pretty much gonna finish the hair off. So anywhere I try to cover out all the white, and I can always add her flesh color back on top. So I don't have to worry about messing it up too much, as long as I have these nice consistent strokes, I'll be okay. I'm liking how this is turning out. See where else I could add a little bit of brown. Maybe. I haven't added the white of the eyes yet, so I don't really have to be cautious around the eyes too much. Cool. There. I think that's fairly good. Now, let's see, what else is left of white? So do I still need to fill in the water in the back? And a little bit of her blue shirt here. Maybe I should finish up her shirt real quick while I have this dark color available. I'll just kind of put the shirt up there. Maybe like one more stroke down here. I think that's good for shirt land. I think I need a little bit darker color though in here, so I'll use the same tone. Now going on top of the color that I just put in. So sometimes your work is never quite done. you can keep going on a painting forever. Alright. So used up that blue. Now I'm gonna try to make a nice bright green for the color of the water. So I'm gonna grab this light blue here. It's a nice, kind of pure light blue. Actually, I'm gonna add a little bit of this before I mix it. Just to get this, these are little reflections of the sky. And again, I'm trying to fill up the white, so not go over too much over the, over the other colors I've already put in. And maybe use the tip a little bit more when I get towards the top of the painting. That'll make the strokes smaller. All right, now I'm gonna add this yellow into here. Hopefully making a kind of bright green, although I know that my colors are, again, since the yellow is so orangey and red, that's gonna counteract my green. So I won't be able to make too bright of a green. In fact, I think this is might be the brightest green I can make. So, that's what I'll use. And that's gonna keep me from going too wild with the background colors, because again, that's not, the background isn't where the focus should be. The focus should be on the face. So it doesn't quite matter if I can't get this brighter green of the actual color of the water. Because I'm living in the rules of this painting, and the rules of this painting are use the three colors. And who makes the rules? I make the rules. If you're the artist, you make the rules. And you can have no rules if you want. But I tend to like having rules in a painting because I think it ties it together and it keeps it from complete chaos, which is how a lot of paintings turn out for me if I have no plan and rules. And this one's turning out pretty good. I'm pretty happy with it so far. Just hope I can keep it going, I guess. I'm gonna add a little bit more blue into this and make it. So now my painting, my paint on my palette is starting to get a little bit gummy and that means that it's starting to dry up on my palette. So I might have to pour some more paint, but usually at that point, that's when I'd like to take a break from the painting. And, oh, I should do that now because I have another class to jump on. So, what good timing. I'm going to wash my brush, turn on Zoom, and I'll check back in after class.
Sometimes my life